8 teams rose above the competition and entered the first strike playoffs, and as the dust from the quarterfinals, then semifinals settled, it was clear that North America would see a crash course between two of its very best competitors, 100 Thieves versus Team Solo Min, the grand finale slugfest between two incredible NA rivals. If you are a fan of Valorant, you owe it to yourself to watch this series. It was exciting, frantic, out of control, and absolutely electric. To go with that, we'll be focusing on really innovative strategies, as well as some of the pure hype plays brought out by these teams. Our map pick bans went this way: Map 1 Split, Map 2 Bind, Map 3 Ascent, Map 4 Haven, and the final decider to be played on Icebox. Jumping right into it, let's go to Split and look in on the fourth round. The round starts with early aggression by 100 Thieves towards B main, trading Omen Smokes and Roombas with TSM. Steel is able to get control of the area and the ultimate orb to bring Lockdown online, nearly killing Sabroza in the process as the Thieves back off and begin to slow rotate towards A. 100 Thieves want to use that early ultimate advantage and go for a straightforward A execute, using Lockdown to open up the site. An important thing to note here is look how not committed to the fake B 100 Thieves here are. If they get a different look from TSM or maybe get all the frags to go their way, then they can just take that advantage and just go A anyway. They're not really committed to anything out the gate. Let's see how it plays out. Steel drops the Lockdown and TSM start responding to the attack. Instead of giving up the site control, Drone goes aggro, unleashing the run it back, dicing up Dicey with an insane Bulldog headshot, yeeting Steel's sentry and somehow getting another clutch Bulldog headshot before the run it back ends, sending Drone back to the loving embrace of Nitro on site. But the damage is done. 100 Thieves have only 2 people left and they're so separated compared to TSM. Not that it matters here, because here comes Sabroza on the ultimate long con flank, catching Higo completely off guard. Nitro tries his best, but gets immediately sat down by Haze, and TSM secure the round in convincing fashion, responding to the ultimate aggression from 100 Thieves very well with their own. We're going to keep up this fast pace showcased by the teams throughout this set by heading straight to Bind, where first things first, I gotta get my highlights out of the way. Going into this tournament, I didn't really know much about Asuna, and for me, considering his role in 100 Thieves, he was my biggest question mark as the games commenced. But on the other side of the tournament, this kid is mustard. He is cash money. Asuna plays like a maniac and showcases the most elite Phoenix usage in the world. But here, he shows his flexibility by piloting an equally deadly Raze on Bind. Now listen, there isn't much to say about this round. Look at this frame here. You are Asuna, and you've just seen or heard Omen Smokes. A Sky Ultimate, a very underrated entry tool by the way. Phoenix flashes, your friendly Omen's paranoia followed by operator shots. It's pretty clear that the enemy is running it down short pretty hard, and have just been stuffed by your Omen. Meaning it's the perfect time to unleash the Showstopper, fly through the sky like a majestic eagle and do this. It's just so good. And so hyped to watch someone defeat an entire team like that. One small thing to note, as it was commented on often throughout this tournament, as you can see, Asuna has a very high mouse sensitivity and overall jittery aim style. This goes against the well-accepted standards of smoother movements of the arm with lower sensitivities to achieve the best aim possible. Asuna's playstyle is unique, and he's gone out of his way to make this aim style work for him, but it's not something I would recommend to the average player, I just wanted to point it out. On the other side of this round exchange, TSM just got bodied in that 8 take, and you might think they would reconsider their strategies going forward, but nope. In the very next round, TSM basically execute the same 8 take, and what I want to highlight here is how different TSM approached Valorant than anyone else in the world right now. TSM have made it their playstyle to run dedicated triple duelist team compositions, most often ditching the typical sentinel slots in favor of a support flash character like Breach or Sky, and their only smoke pick, Omen. This is obviously a very offensive and aggressive team style, and the big thing it forces is a different approach to common situations that are otherwise solved by Sentinel support. As in this round here, where after quick trades for U-Haul control, TSM have a smoke in heaven and no other utility to cover the truck plant. Let's pause here and look at what TSM should know. Well, they haven't cleared showers or backsite, and the heaven smoke is set to clear as the plant is going down. They don't have access to another smoke or stuff like cypher cages or sage walls to protect the spike planter. So what do you do in this situation? TSM bring the Secret Service to make sure ain't no one touching the plant. Sabroza on short covering U-Haul, Wardell on truck next to the planter ready to delete the showers player, and Drone to watch over truck and cover heaven. This is in some ways can be better than the old slap a sage wall and call it a day strategy. Watch how it plays out here. Steel, deleted in showers, Asuna, decked in heaven, and plant secured. At that point, it's already a round win assuming no miracle plays from 100 Thieves. The Wardell pick onto Dicey shortly after secures it. This kind of divide and conquer playstyle is what's necessary to make the Triple Duelist core work. And while it certainly is hit or miss, when it hits, TSM can just run over rounds like nothing else I've ever seen in Valorant. Now, continuing this theme about the three Duelist core, we're heading over to Ascent and looking at round 6 of TSM's defense. A core pillar of Ascent's defense is proactive rotation instead of reactive rotation. The difference being that good Ascent teams can read the game and preemptively rotate extra players ahead of a push to help bolster the site defenses, instead of only rotating after the site take has already happened. This is easily facilitated by Sentinels and heavy defense compositions featuring Sova, Cypher, Killjoy, and even the Rogue Sage. TSM only have one aspect of that defensive backbone, and that's Cutler on the Sova. This means that TSM is essentially very weak to fakes. If they proactively rotate but get faked out, they have no utility to help prevent the opposite site being taken. Credit to Sean Garris for pointing this out during the cast, by the way. I didn't really pick up on it until he pointed it out, but it's very clear once you see it. So, what does this all mean in terms of how TSM play their defense? Well, it boils down to leaving players to linger at their positions as long as possible and rely on the skill of their teammates where the push may be happening to succeed without them. It also means that they have to be very sturdy and immune to jumping at fakes. Let's see how it plays out in this round. Things start off at a breakneck pace with 100 Thieves instantly going for B main control and popping off the Reyna ultimate. Now, I'm no expert, but usually, keyword here, usually, when you hear multiple footsteps and the all-purpose entry tool in the Reyna ultimate, this is a B-rush, and this is a B-rush to everyone watching and probably even TSM. Watch the minimap here and see how they reorganize their defense. Cutler rotates to mid and Wardell takes the operator to A Heaven while Haze slides into Tree Room. This isn't the rotation of a team concerned about a B rush, and it's because of the communication. The B players are like, yo, they haven't pushed out yet. So Brozo is poking into the Omen smoke and gets that key intel for his team. As the smoke clears, the Thieves send another big signal for the B hit with the Killjoy lockdown. But now TSM are ready, they have the setup they want to hold for all these scenarios. Cutler lets the Sova ultimate bang and neutralizes the lockdown even as Asuna secures the first pick of the round. The big issue for 100 Thieves at this point is that they took too long and didn't commit the fake well enough. They sort of just used ultimates in B main and just sat there. This let TSM play patient, and all of that leads to Wardell, the best operator player in North America, just chilling on A to spoil the A tank. Brilliant patience from TSM, but it's a play of necessity because of their unique team composition. I wanted to highlight this round specifically because in matchmaking you see a lot of duelist heavy compositions because solo queue players will just play how they want. Oftentimes it can feel suffocating to play without sentinels and four dudes just running Jet 1, Jet 2, Jet 3, and Jet 4, but I think TSM make that playstyle look so much more viable if you take the time to practice the tendencies that they do. Kinda on the total opposite of the tactical spectrum, we need to take just another moment to highlight Phoenix in this current meta. I'm saying it now, and we'll continue to do so until something significant changes. Phoenix is an S tier agent. Phoenix is the best second duelist on the roster as of right now. Literally, the sixth man of Valorant. Phoenix won't be the hard carry or star player pick of a team, but my god, his impact when played well is absolutely unparalleled. Watch how this round plays out for TSM. The round starts with, oh! Steel gets a pick on Sabrosa. 100 Thieves rotate to mid, and there's Asuna just outdoing Wardell, and getting what feels like a 100 Thieves second uncontested pick in this round. And now TSM are in a bad spot. 3v5 with not much looking good until Drone goes into defense mode. And watch this. Drone gets the perfect pick on the Nitro and identifies the market push is coming. He gets across to the B side of spawn and hot hands the mid corridor and doesn't hesitate to commit the Phoenix ultimate to the cause. Watch how he plays this here, he doesn't just skirt around the corner towards market, he messes with 100 Thieves' timing by hesitating a few seconds. This allows him to get that crucial pick on Dicey even if he's instantly traded out. Back at his ultimate respawn point, Cutler with the clutch teamwork watching his buddy's back perfectly anticipating the mid pinch swings this round to a 3v2 from a fully 100 Thieves' favored situation. From here it's just TSM's round to win, with Drone and Cutler swinging out from spawn to finish off the rebound, with Drone just taking over and carding a saucy 4-piece. Just Phoenix, my friends. Play Phoenix if you're looking for a duelist character. Jumping right to Haven, let's take a look at the most dreaded scenario known to man in Valorant. The complete A-site retake in the post plant. A-site, we know it, we hate it, and even more than attacking it, we hate retaking it after it's been lost. As we've talked about previously, A is a fortress of doom and it can be nearly impossible to work with sometimes. So, what can we do to even out the odds? Well, I think the key is to slice up site control. If we look at A from our top-down perspective, yeah, I know it's been a while, but here we are. Assuming no flanks to attack or spawn, There's only two entrances into sight, one of which is a jump, limiting accuracy in the moment, and the thing shared between both entrances are the 500 angles that could be watching them both. Knowing this, we can watch what TSM do here and adapt some of this into our play. While we've been setting this up, the round has been playing out, and aside from a pick by Sabrosa as the spike goes down, TSM now face a 5v4 retake scenario. Now here, we need to fall back to our pillars of good retakes. 1. Speed. 2. Site control. Especially here, because of how much offsite play happens on Haven post plants, you need your site control ASAP. TSM executed this way. Drone is covering long A from Heaven and hasn't dropped on the site yet. Haze smokes short A, isolating the site anchors. So with these two things, like half of the angles that pressure the entry to the site are limited, and TSM can swarm in. Dicey is just a man on an island here, and in his attempt to help him out, Austin just creates a 2v1 trade for TSM. At this point, this divide and conquer retake style has given them site control, and allows them to deal with the usually difficult post-plant defenses from Sova that would otherwise harass them. Moving on to round 11, let's observe some great Omen mind games as well as the inherent pressure of site anchoring on Haven. Now, a lot of cool stuff is going to happen this round, but I want to first focus on Haze playing C anchor for TSM. This position, this ungodly burden that Haze carries, is the worst in the game in my opinion. C-site is not only a pain to actually defend, if you were to say, lose A, well, it's about 2 or 3 lifetimes to schlep across the map to help the rotate. It sucks, and part of the reason why you see a lot of Omens soloing C is the godsend of the teleport as a fast rotation method. Just keep that in mind as we watch the round play out. We got some feints and thrusts towards A to start with the duelists of each team pushing for footage on long A. A minor note here, TSM are still on that triple duelist comp, and they tend to favor a very aggressive defensive style on Haven, and have full pushed A in this half already. But here, the pop of the Reyna ultimate by TSM kinda has both teams playing a bit back and seeing who will make the first mistake. TSM get a deeper hold on long as 100 Thieves establish a good foothold in short, but note on the minimap here, the spike and two players are still towards C for 100 Thieves, indicating some sort of fake. As we get to 1 minute on the round timer, we see the execution come out from the Thieves. A late Cypher K is thrown in the beginning of the round, pops out to block long A as Asuna uses his Phoenix Wall to cut off the site tunnel and isolates the fights towards long and Heaven. And here, the brilliant moment comes out. As Asuna jumps into site, Nitro from C long pops his Omen ult and teleports onto A site. He has two goals here. 1. Intel on the players in either the long A corner or under Heaven. 2. Make TSM think it's a full commit A. And watch what this does to our boy Hazed. As Asuna and Dicey trade onto site, Haze is forced to make a call and teleport out to help the A-hold. He goes to long A for the fast flank. Hiko near the long entrance hears it and backs out towards mid to play Ultra Lurk. Meanwhile, Nitro and Steel have just been gifted free site control on C. An absolutely brilliant fake using the Omen ults lets 100 Thieves completely catch TSM off guard, leading to Lurk kills from Hiko and a clutch pick from Steel setting up the almost inevitable clutch from the Sova God himself in the 2v1. This kind of next level mid round calling seemed to put 100 Thieves above TSM constantly throughout this set. While TSM would bring up moments of individual brilliance that would trump the Thieves, it never felt like TSM brought a strat book, wink wink nudge nudge, that could compete. They would cut to the player cams between rounds, and honestly Haze looked lost sometimes at what Steel was calling in the set, and I think that bore out in the end results with TSM just slowly falling further and further behind. In the end, all this culminated in a 3-1 series win for 100 Thieves, netting them the title of North America's First Strike Champions. Overall, 100 Thieves came out of this as the scariest team in NA for me, and by far the standout successes of this tournament were the immaculate entry play by Asuna on attack, backed up by the sturdiness of Hiko in the clutch on both sides. Nitro proves himself to not be too far off the star player moniker he carried early on in his CS career, despite being an in-game leader for the last few years. And Dicey and Steel are just consistent game in and game out performers. Steel's game sense and IQ are just so high, and honestly his lurk game on attack is deadly. Dicey is no slash on the operator as well, leaving this 100 Thieves side with basically no immediate weakness. Time will tell if they can rise to the heights of dominance shown so far by G2 in Europe, but I believe they can do it. And that's it. This video is the culmination of a lot of work from us here at SteelCapped. We had an insane time making this tournament coverage, and I really want to give a special shout out to our amazing team of editors who put in some crazy hours while I scrapped for a nap between games. Without this editing, these videos just don't happen. First Strike was a wild tournament, and I want to stress that we only covered two regions. I heard from other people that the Asian tournaments were also crazy, which is just a great sign for Valorant going forward. Hopefully, once the craziness in the world settles down, we can see what happens to the pro scene when all of these amazing players can meet in a truly international tournament. Congrats once again to all of the teams participating, and let us know if we should cover some of the other First Strike finals in the comments down below. Make sure to subscribe and like the video as well for more premium guides just like this one, with one goal in mind: helping you become a better player. We here at SkillCopter would like to thank you for watching, and we will see you in the next one. And to everyone, I hope you guys have a happy and safe holidays. Much love, and thank you guys for watching.